And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Monastery, the open bar of the internet, the world's greatest shit show, and the place where we, the good brothers and sisters of this most holy of temples, seek enlightenment through the drunkest, craziest, and most batshit ways possible. I am your one and only gaming monk, better known as Mildra, and it is October 10th. Welcome back to the Gazette, ladies and gentlemen. I have the newest good brother anointed to the temple, who has been bathed in the holy beer of the monastery. A long suffering member of Atlanta who has to watch Heimlich perform his lessons every week. And, or rather, let me rephrase that, Georgia, you're not in Atlanta technically. And the king of memes, Mr. Akira Koops.
How's it going, everyone?
Dragon, the reason you don't see any is because you haven't believed enough. It is only rewarded to those with faith. Also, if you're going in looking for Budweiser, shame on you, man.
Hey, like you said, even the devil eats flies. Mm-hmm.
So, I am in a good mood this week because I have managed to get under the proverbial threshold that I was trying to shoot for was to get under 250 before the end of October. Why the end of October? Because, well, obviously after that is going to be holiday hell, and you know how it is with families and Thanksgiving and Christmas.
Man's got to eat after all.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have one of those kind of families that won't let you leave unless they feel you've had your full meal.
Trust me, my family's the same way. So I can relate.
Look, the only hard and fast rules that I have when it comes to holiday eating is don't give me fruitcake. Fortunately, nobody in my family does fruitcake, and no matter how many times you tell me it's good, I'm not eating chitlins.
Yo, Pax, I hate the fact that they try to offer me chitlins every single Christmas, man.
Look, guys. I want to make clear that I am not averse to having soul food. I've had it in one form or another my whole life. But there are some parts of it that I say absolutely no. I cannot even stand the smell of chitlins. And
I can't stand that. Can't stand net bones. You name it, I just can't stand it.
Yeah, And I've had pig ears a couple times. It was okay. Game fan, if you don't know what chitlins are, look it up. Obviously there's not gonna be a whole lot of that going on. The very least during Thanksgiving, I can indulge in turkey because, for whatever reason, the whole tryptophan thing doesn't work on me. I have no idea why.
That's strange.
There's the unwritten rule that if there's casserole on the table, you don't call it that. You call it hot dish, because Minnesota.
We just call it casserole here in the South.
Although I do have to ask the obvious question: Is it pronounced pecans or pecans?
Tomato tomato, depending on which area you're in. But I know most Atlantans will call it like pecans.
Mm-hmm. I'm guessing they'd call it that just to distract themselves from all the horrors of Atlanta traffic.
That's not even the worst of it.
Okay, well, not everybody can be as bad as LA traffic. Yes, I'm saying LA traffic is worse.
I can see that. Yeah.
Ethereal Dragon, I'm not in New York. And my rule with New York is I've got no beef with New York State. I've got all the beef with New York City.
Brunette.
But let's get started with the Kickstarter spotlight. And the first one we've got is Suzerain Legends. Now, I will disclose the fact that, one, I did back this. Two, I have had Miles M. Kentier, the head of Savage Mojo, on the show in the past. And three, I did reach out to him to come back. It's 50-50. He asked me to contact him again in a couple weeks, and we'll see how it goes.
Okay.
It mostly has to deal with health reasons. I don't want to go into the specifics.
Fair enough.
Yeah. But Suzerain Legends has been around for a while, which is probably the reason this got funded in 5 minutes. Especially since he was only asking for 2,500, and he's currently at 10,700.
With 7 days to go, I think you might get more.
Yeah. Now, Suzerain has been around for almost 20 years. And it was actually one of the earliest adopters of the Savage Worlds system. It was born from the idea of, instead of just picking one style of RPG to do, let's do all of them.
Yeah, that sounds like one big mess right there. But if it's been going on for like 20 years or so, it seems like it's working.
Yeah. Obviously, the original version of Suzerain predates Savage Worlds, and he said he's not a fan of that original system, but I don't know, I didn't mind it. But the whole idea with Suzerain is a fantastical multiverse. So if you want to go modern stuff, high fantasy, if you want to go SF, you want to go space opera, you want to go low fantasy, can it do that? The answer is yes.
So anything you think of, you can actually do.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
Yeah. This is updating, because of the fact that Savage Worlds recently updated to what's known as Adventurer Edition, which has been given the unfortunate nickname of Suede. They're redoing Suzerain under the banner of Suzerain Legends, using the changes that Adventure Edition brings in. They've been doing this across three editions. They've done Steampunk Fairies through Clockwork Dreams, Spartans in Space through Dogs of Hades, a rogue Egyptian god through Set Rising, and 8 million vampires in a cybernetic city in Shanghai Vampocalypse. All of this within the Suzerain setting. So now they want to do one story across seven linked realms. And build it around...
I can only imagine how that is going to be pulled off.
Building it around making characters who feel like superheroes from any genre. I do find it interesting. I'll have to ask him about this regarding the notion of high school textbook RPG product. I'm curious what he meant by that. Now, there is a primer version available now that's only like 94 pages that goes through the universe through a heroic eye. But for this Kickstarter, it's being made into a full-on, full-sized book.
Now, wow. Mm-hmm. That ought to be fun.
Yeah. So first, they're adding sections for a bestiary, namely with a whole lot of templates, so you can have a whole lot of combinations on NPCs or monsters that you can put in. Second is a plot point campaign to hit the ground running for characters being introduced into the Suzerain universe. And of course, they're going to be doing some more edits on the primer manuscript, because as he points out, you can never have too much editing. Unless you're DC Comics, because fuck Dan DiDio.
Fuck him to hell.
Mm-hmm. And apparently they're doing a mega bundle that called 20 Years of Suzerain, which is going to combine all of the key titles that they did back in the Continuum edition, which I have and is pretty good. Caladan Falls, Dogs of Hades, Clockwork Dreams, Set Rising, Noir Knights, Millennium Knights, Tomb of the Lich Queen, Machine of the Lich Queen, Palace of the Lich Queen, Shintar Legends Arise, and Shintar Legends Unleashed. Oh yeah, and Shanghai Vampocalypse. I won't be doing the mega. I didn't do the mega bundle when I pitched in, because all of those I already have. I realize that's a case of this is my surprised face with me saying that, but it is what it is.
Right, right.
And then we get into a bit of the setting. So 120 years ago, an event called the Pulse War divided the Earth, and the story of Suzerain Legends consists of seven linked lands crisscrossed with portals. And while the heroes can travel between these portals, so can their enemies. So let's see, we have Austeria, Fantasy at War.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. Gather All, Heroic Cyberpunk. Shintar, Epic High Fantasy. Winterlands, a supercharged post-apocalypse. Dungeonlands, The Killer Dungeon. Let's see. Untamed Empires, so with muskets and magic. The Feylands, self-explanatory.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then we have the stretch goals that they're going into. Looks like if they get 11,000, they'll do a print-on-demand version. If they get 12,000, they'll do an upgrade for Suzerain Legends Chapter 4. At 12.5, something. See, then who is MMK? He prefers the word wizened to old because people think it means wise, since he's been gaming since the 70s.
Right.
But yeah, Suzerain originally came around in 1997. I had first found out about it in 2002.
1997. I think I was around 7 around that time.
Mm-hmm.
That's been that long.
Yep. Let's see. Then finding out more. Risks and challenges. And the rest. I'd say this is probably gonna get probably gonna get 1,300 by the end of it. It's got 7 days to go.
Yeah, I can see 1,300 too. They're gonna make it.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. So next is the Cosmic Dragon Breviary. A 5e compendium that is all about dragons. They asked for 1,000. They managed to get 12,000 in change so far with 10 days to go.
Xanatrix, what's up, man?
Hey, you made it.
I did. I just had to get dinner. Tonight is a good night.
Yes, it is. I'm under 250 now.
Very cool. Awesome.
But yeah, we're currently on the Cosmic Dragon Breviary. Which I think I just wrote as Cosmic Dragon because I didn't want to misspell Breviary. So this apparently is developed by a Florida man.
Oh God.
Well, Tallahassee.
That's still... Oh, nowhere near Shays then.
Mm-hmm. So it is an expansion to 5e's rule set focused solely on cosmic dragons. These
dragons mm-hmm. that look like they're made from stars and black holes and shit. Okay. Yep.
And a bunch of dragonborn ancestries.
Oh God. Dragonborn races, you mean?
Yeah. Look, folks, it's races, not ancestries. Deal with it.
Races, not ancestries. Races, not lineages. They're fucking races. It's more like race with this than it would be in real life with the different ethnicities.
Mm-hmm. So apparently the idea is that the cosmic dragons are a set of neutral dragons between metallic and chromatic that want to perpetuate balance in the multiverse.
So a bunch of draconic druids?
Let's see, they can be found in a wide array of locales and on nearly every plane, making them a perfect fit for any campaign. Let's see, nebula dragons can thrive anywhere that fine particles abound, from deserts to mountains. Planetary dragons may contest territories otherwise claimed by green, white, or red dragons. I'm sorry, but when you call them cosmic dragons like that, people are going to think dragons in space. And while I have no problem with that, I feel like trying to fit them into other campaigns in this regard by having them be the neutral example between metallic and chromatic.
Chromatic.
When I think about cosmic dragons, I think about the stuff that usually gets on a Rhapsody album.
Yes. Abso-fucking-lutely, yes.
Or Lost Horizon, for anyone who remembers that.
Linked Horizon also has a lot of good stuff.
But apparently the book is complete as far as the manuscript. They just need to get the They just need to get more art. Eventually they plan on releasing the thing for free. Let's see, 22 monsters, a bunch of lore, the cosmic dragonborn race, two subclasses, the dragon apprentice ranger and the draconic weave sorcerer. Really, that's it. A dragonborn racial feat to amp up breath weapon. Except, whenever I see feats added into 5e sandbox, I'm like, okay. But the problem is, you're only going to have 4 feats for a full adventuring career. Like, you're not going to have a whole lot of opportunity to really take advantage of feats because they decided to do the whole. Oh, you're only getting feats every 4 levels, no matter what your class. Compare that with
I miss the feeder. 3.5 may have had a lot of bloat, but you know, a fighter being able to take a feat, take a page and a half of feats was always fun.
Fantasy Craft manages to do 3.5's feats better because it's more organized, and every class is going to be getting a fair amount of bonus feats. It's just what family of feats you're getting those bonus feats in.
And I'm guessing Fantasy Craft also doesn't have the insane amount of feat bloat that made it so that there were only certain feats you wanted to take in the first place.
No. If anything, you're going to have a problem where there's so many feats and none of them are bad ideas.
See, this is why I love Fantasy Craft.
Mm-hmm. Let's see, and then we go to the pledge levels. Apparently they're also doing a book called Cosmic Minions and More. A alternate cover, which looks like the kind of covers I'd see from Castles and Crusades. A handbook called Masters of the Gauntlet, which features a infinity domain for clerics, I'm guessing, and the Oath of Purification for paladins. Which, if I was using Legend System, with the way it does paths and subtypes for classes, I'd probably be a little more excited. But let's see then. So apparently they are doing a Cosmic Knight fighter in the thing, as well as a balanced domain, a draconic script book. Like the it's nice and all, but there's not a whole lot I can see myself using this with. The big problem is that for me the 5e material that I'm willing to back tends to be the material that adds something to the sandbox. That was the reason why I backed the 5e version of Spheres and Might and Spheres of Power. Because with the sphere system being a spellcasting and martial alternative, that's adding something to the sandbox. Nightfell is skewing the default rules to aim more for dark fantasy. As well as a whole system regarding lunar phases and how that affects monsters. That's adding something to the sandbox. And you get the idea. But this one, it's just more. I know somebody might say, well, what about the subclasses? Don't those add something to the sandbox? Not as much, comparatively speaking. Not when there's already a glut of subclasses as it is, and the problem that I have with the subclass system as it's presented has always been, once you pick it, you're stuck with it.
So no class changes or nothing.
Oh, you can multi-class, but nobody really does it because,
except classing for 5e is underpowered as hell.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. It's
clear that they don't want people multi-classing, which I argue it's stupid, and two, this is a problem that's already been fixed. Like I mentioned, Legend does the track system where if somebody wanted to you're almost encouraged to do some form of multi-classing.
I love Legend. That homebrew system, I'm still sad that its support died, but at least we got a full set of rules out of it, and that multi-track system is just the customization is endless. Yeah.
I did review Legend System a while back, and I might go into detail showing why I love that particular system. There of course was multi-classing in Fantasy Craft, which was more akin to the 3.5 style, although it's a little bit kinder to you. But personally, my favorite version of multiclassing is the kind that's seen in D&D 4th edition and 13th age. As with 4th edition, multiclassing was relegated to feats. So you take it and you trade out a power that you might have gotten from your base class instead with one that might be at a lower level from another class. You're dipping into another class, which is the sole reason people multi-class anyways.
That makes sense.
And with 13th age, there are certain talents you can get at first level so that you can get access at two levels lower to say if you're a cleric but you wanted to do a few wizard tricks, you can take a talent and have it that you can, that when you get access to new spells, you can choose one from the wizard spell list at two levels lower than your current.
Okay.
Good.
One last comment. Just as a side note, what he means by Fantasy Craft being kinder about multiclassing is that you don't need an Excel spreadsheet to plot every level of every class you're going to multiclass into to get the perfect stat upgrades and feats at the perfect times. Because that actually happened in 3.5. People would literally use Excel to plot their road from 1 to 20.
Mm-hmm. I see.
Lord knows I did it. So next, in one of our first comic entries for the Kickstarter spotlight, we have Thomas Moria, Wizard for Hire.
Seen this.
Yeah, you probably have. It's been making the rounds. So it is an urban fantasy. It was 2 years ago, Thomas Moria's wife was kidnapped by one of the Nine Kings of Hell. He's out for vengeance as he fights for his love's soul. Can he save her without starting a war with all the dark supernatural world? Okay, let's get the obvious out of the way. Some of you are probably thinking of either Constantine, Dr. Fate, or Harry Dresden.
I'd say he's closest to Dresden.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But with a better looking beard.
I was about to say, I love his beard. And I love the fact that he does the fisticuffs in hell.
Mm-hmm.
So I think he's been taking lessons from a certain Blazkowicz family.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that particular theory has been coming about how all of the id characters are in the same lineage.
It's semi-confirmed by id at this point.
Although I did like John Romero's little comment about how Doomguy's real name is Doomguy.
Yeah, John Romero is kind of irrelevant these days. Dai Katana kind of killed him.
Soundtracks, what's up?
Yep.
Go.
Azel, you are the second person who is late and gay.
Yeah, but none of us can actually be as late or as gay as Doku.
No.
Yeah. Where are we on this thing?
Thomas Moria.
Okay, so I just got here. Cool. Mm-hmm.
Ethereal saying, hopefully my comics will make your live streams when they're near completion. Well, we'll cross that bridge when we get to there.
Yeah.
But, I gotta say, I do like the art style I'm seeing, and this particular image here I absolutely love. I always like that kind of contrast.
Which one of the pictures?
So the one where he's approaching his car, you see his shadow, and his shadow has wings.
Oh yeah, that's a cool picture. Mm-hmm. I really like that.
Somebody's going for their inner Batman.
actually, I'd say this reminds me more of the Akira poster.
That too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that too.
Yeah.
Except he's not already on his vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
But no, the wings actually remind me more of Azrael. If you're gonna go with Batman references, the supernatural guy who takes over as Batman for a little while Batman is dead.
Oh yeah.
He wasn't dead. He was crippled.
Oh.
He showed up during Nightfall. Remember?
Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of Darkest Night, where Batman was sent into it. He was technically killed, but not, and sent into a time. Darkest Night was fucking weird. Let's put it that way.
Blackest Night was fine. Final Crisis was the case of what the fuck.
Yeah.
And then, of course, you know, we have the whole Flashpoint bullshittery.
Yeah.
But we're off topic.
Yeah, so apparently we have a beam struggle involving eyes.
Yeah, I saw that.
We're going to be fighting with the ancient Egyptian laser beams.
And, you know...
My only thought was, is this a death gaze fighting another death gaze?
You know, I have to take back the comparison that I made with Dr. Fate, and even the comparison I made with Harry Dresden. He's reminding me more and more of Constantine. Just a little less English,
and a little more dapper.
Yeah,
that beard just screams dapper.
Mm-hmm.
Along with the suit vest.
Yeah. Doesn't help that he's got a better ride. Yeah. Let's see. Stefani Renee is writing, co-writer Red Smith, colorist and editor is Stefani Renee. So this is largely a one person show.
Nice.
And Stefani Renee is a Brazilian born, so mm-hmm. Awesome to see more people up and running from all over the place.
Yep.
Because I know that a lot of U.S. Comic book artists are. Well, I'll just leave that there.
Well, as we've said before, if you slack on the throne, then somebody's gonna take it.
And I sure as fuck hope they do.
So they're only asking for 6,500. They are at 8,600 with 51 days to go. This is getting made and then some.
Yep.
All right. So next we have our first art book entry on the monastery.
Ooh.
A sketch and doodle book from the legendary Simon Bisley.
Very cool.
AKA the guy who did a lot of work for ABC Warriors, Slain, and also the creator of, I believe either the creator or one of the people who was responsible for the popularity of Lobo. Even though Lobo was a joke that nobody got.
Lobo's a big joke. Everybody laughs at him. For the wrong reasons, usually, though.
Mm-hmm. But, yeah, he's... of course, he did a fair amount of stuff on Lobo. He did a fair amount of stuff on 2000 AD and Judge Dredd magazine. He also, in 2006, he worked on a Halo graphic novel.
Yep.
Nice.
He's been around.
Very prolific.
Mm-hmm.
I like that sketch of a Boba Fett with a bow.
Yeah.
Making him Boba Fett. Yep.
And I know some people might cry foul at this particular print of the Ninja Turtles, but I'd say this is more in line with the original comic, not with the Ninja Turtles we're all familiar with.
They're all Raphael. They're all pissed off and ready to kick ass. They're all Raphael.
Well, remember the original comic.
I know.
Was a giant parody.
Based off of the, and they tried to tie it to one of Daredevil's origins as part of that parody. Mm-hmm. They hinted at it, but they never said it was.
Well, they couldn't outright state it because that'd be grounds for a lawsuit.
Yeah, right. But it's the chemicals that blinded him going down the drain, mm-hmm. stuff like that.
Yep, but now the image in the sketchbook, which is going to be a minimum 100 pages, will have previously unpublished work, and he wanted to do this because with the cancellation of so many comic conventions, he wanted to give fans a chance to get sketches directly from him.
Admirable.
Mm-hmm.
I can respect that.
See, then we have a softback version, a variant version. I do like that sketch. And a hardback edition, which I really like that sketch. And Frostmourne, eat your heart out. Look, you guys know I love me some... You guys know I love me some heavy metal fantasy.
Oh, yeah.
And this qualifies. This is a public service announcement from the monastery. Buy Brutal Legend if you don't have it already.
If you like rock, heavy metal and rock and roll, if you like dark fantasy, if you like killing things using the power of rock, or if you like rock legends from across the times, and of course, if you like Jack Black, you're going to absolutely fucking love Brutal Legend. So, mm-hmm.
Such a good game.
Yep. So let's see. So we have some black and white portrait samples, some color portrait samples.
That's a cool Darth Maul. I like that.
Not great.
Mm-hmm. Fucking cool. Yep.
I have to wonder if somebody suggested the Boba Fett thing as a joke.
I bet they did, and I bet he took it to heart because that's hilarious.
Mm-hmm.
It is a pun that fits, and I can actually see Boba Fett using an actual bow.
Yeah. Let's see. Color figure samples. So, he doesn't do a half-bad Power Girl. And that's not a half-bad Iron Fist, either. The third character, I'm not quite... familiar with who that is. The fourth one is Dawn.
Yep.
And yeah, that is a pretty nice Darth Maul there.
Exactly. And of course there's Lobo.
Mm-hmm. We've also got Swamp Thing and Constantine. Nice. Some color commission samples.
It's an amazing Swamp Thing. Mm-hmm. That's a lot of minute detail. And he went the extra mile.
Yeah, the thing to appreciate when it comes to Simon Bisley's art style is how detailed he is. Which leads me to wonder why he never did anything for old school Warhammer or early Warhammer 40K.
Maybe GW just didn't want to pay him?
That makes too much sense.
It makes all of the sense. It's GW. Come on now.
Yeah. All right, so the next one, and if you guys saw, I did have Craig Campbell on earlier today to talk about this. Good Strong Hands RPG, which is meant to be a darkly whimsical game about saving a fantastical world you've been thrown into. Make your isekai jokes. I know you got them.
I don't have an isekai joke, but when I first saw this, it kind of reminded me of Guardians of the Galaxy, only with corrupted fairy tale creatures.
He's stated that he draws inspiration from The Neverending Story, Legend, The Dark Crystal, fuck you, Netflix, Labyrinth, and Willow.
So, from all of my childhood fantasy movies that I love to death.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
By the way, I'm sure you heard me humming the NeverEnding Story theme.
Yeah,
I heard it.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, how can you not make the NeverEnding Story connection with the name?
Mm-hmm.
Good, strong hands.
Yep.
You know, Rockbiter couldn't save his own son with his good, strong hands. That was his whole, like, that soliloquy, that was, you know, just before we lose our tax to the swamp of despair.
Mm.
I have seen that cosplay, by the way. There is a person who has cosplayed at cons as Trey trying to pull Artax out of the swamp.
If you ever find a photo of that, I want to see that.
I definitely can.
Yep. Now, when it comes to the combatant image, I know somebody is gonna be like, see that. Is going to look at that and see, there's nothing wrong with the combat wheelchair. This sort of wheelchair I don't have a problem with because, well, it's just what it is.
Yep.
And in a magical setting like this, I could see somebody weaponizing a wheelchair.
In council, monk.
All right, let me take a look.
there are no words for the insanity of this cosplayer. There are no words.
I love it. It's brilliant. It's like a semi-budget cosplay, but it works.
You work with what you got, and what he got. It's brilliant. Yep. It's amazing.
So, Good Strong Hands is meant to be an accessible game. Very game around the family or game at cons kind of thing.
Yeah.
So easy to pick up, easy to put down. That's good.
Yeah. It does have kind of a playbook like attitude with character sheet and character advancement. Especially since it's using a D6 system, where you only have to worry about four traits, each of them rated 1 through 4, and you're rolling D6s, and the DM is going to determine whether it's a easy, medium, or difficult challenge, i.e. whether it's 4 to pass, 5 to pass, or 6 to pass. And the thing that Craig mentioned when I talked with him, this is a player-facing game, kind of like Numenera, in the sense that the GM doesn't roll.
Mm-hmm. You just choose a difficulty, and then the player has to roll towards that difficulty. Yeah.
And they're already doing form-fillable playbooks, nice, and a creative folk book for people who want to make their own, which I'm perfectly fine with. And let's see. So, and then they're going to be adding a few more. When it comes to the 12,000 one, which I do think he'll get, animates are inanimate objects given life, and paragons, I guess the best way to describe that is, do you remember, say, the Lord of All Eagles or the Lord of All Horses in Lord of the Rings?
Yep.
It's kind of like that. Yeah. Another example that he gave is, if Arslan was not just a Christ figure, but was just the King of Lions.
Aslan.
Mm-hmm.
Aslan.
Yeah, I know. And if they do well enough, they'll get the whole thing printed at a print shop with Smythe soon binding.
Hmm.
Let's see. And then we have the whole concept of hero schemes, such as the following, a few add-ons, and some of the other stuff that's been worked on. And one of the contributors, Stefan Pennington. I'll give you props for the top hat, but I have to dock points for beard dye.
Yeah, bright blue beard is a. You should have just kept it natural, bruh. Yep. That's good, though.
Mm-hmm. So he was asking for 3,000. He's at 10,400 with 12 days to go. I think he's going to make it. He'll probably he'll probably get that stretch goal for the Paragons.
He's at how many thousand right now?
10,000 and change.
Yeah, and he's just got to get to 12,000. Yeah, he's good.
Yeah.
He's good.
So next we have Worlds Without Number, a sandbox RPG combined with world-building tools and GM helps compatible with Stars Without Number. Now, I do want to make note that a while back for a previous project, I did contact Kevin Crawford to see if he'd do an interview. He doesn't do interviews, so that was out.
Yeah, that's too bad. But that, you know, I can understand some of these guys why they wouldn't want to.
Mm-hmm.
It makes sense.
At the very least, he gave a good reason, unlike some people I've reached out to who gave me a less good reason. Oh, you're an istaphobe. I don't want to interview you. Which has happened a few times.
Istaphobe?
That's what I'm using the term. They didn't actually use that term, but you get the idea.
It's just like, what?
One person called me homophobic.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, come on.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
I've been called a homophobe, I've been called a misogynist, I've been called a racist by some. all of which are equally hilarious because you guys know that I hate every race equally.
That is true.
Mm-hmm.
Why would they call you an istaphobe when an istaphobe is what they are doing to you? That's my question.
I did hold myself back. I could say so you're denying a black man an opportunity.
There's a very old proverb, Monk. Don't hate the player, hate the game. If you're playing the game by their rules, they can't hate you for it.
Right.
Also, unfortunately, I don't have enough dreads to pull off Booker T. And I'm not gonna grow dreads and then tie them out to make it look like I've got a yarn ball glued to my head. Seriously, Booker, what the hell would you do that? If you don't want braids flopping all over the place, just cut them off.
Maybe he's just going insane.
It's Booker T.
Okay, going insane-er.
Yeah. Anyway,
come on.
I do want to make clear, I fucking love Crawford's work. When it comes, he is probably my favorite author in the OSR scene. And if you need an example as to why, go watch my review of Stars Without Number.
It was a good game too.
Or Godbound as well, which was so good it completely replaced Exalted for me.
We need to play that sometime, Monk. Mm-hmm. You said we were gonna at some point.
Yeah, I know. But yeah, it is. So for. With Worlds Without Number, the assumption that could be made is that this is meant to be a fantasy version of Stars Without Number.
I wonder if you could transition between the two.
You probably could.
I would love something I have always had trouble finding a single system for, because I really don't think it can be done with a single system. You'd have to use universal systems anyway. Is a way to transition between sci-fi and fantasy in a nearly seamless effect.
Mm-hmm. Wine did it fairly all right. There was in the deluxe version of Stars Without Number, there was material where you could kind of start to integrate some of Godbound's rules into Stars Without Number.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not impossible.
Just very difficult.
Mm-hmm. But it looks like this is going to be doing a more fantasy approach, but with his quality as well. Let's see, it says, in the system-specific portion of the book, you'll get everything you need to play classic fantasy adventures in an untamed realm. Old-school character creation, rules and classes, the unique talents and knacks of foci, the traditions of high magic and stranger sorcery to fuel occult character concepts, and system mechanics that are familiar to many but refined with practical experience.
That's cool.
Mm-hmm. So he's adding a faction system.
Mm-hmm.
Very nice. Project guide, major projects, because heroes think big and want to leave their mark on a setting, which is something that we saw in Godbound that I kind of touched on in my review of that, but I didn't go into a lot of detail when it came to, I believe it was the Dominion system. How you could spend Dominion to do major projects.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. Setting creation tools. Depending on how the setting creation tools show up, I may have to earmark that for a future Geek Watch.
Another round of world building.
Yes.
Oh, God.
Yeah, those world building streams are actually pretty fun.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I had fun last time we did it. I had fun with the character building we just did. So, yeah, I like doing those things.
Mm-hmm.
I think I like most of all about this project is his statement about why there are no stretch goals.
Yep. And let's see. And apparently he's also providing a free edition. So he's doing the same thing he did with Stars Without Number in Godbound, where there's a free edition and then there's a deluxe edition.
Mm-hmm.
The free edition contains the basics of the rule set, while there's extra stuff in the deluxe edition. So in the deluxe edition, we have legates and basically epic level heroism for those who want to take this low fantasy game and make it to an epic fantasy approach. More classes, extra planar worlds, one role tables for topics relevant to a GM's interest. So basically, if you need some inspiration, grab one die of each type, give it a toss, and stitch the results together. I'm using that. I feel like I need Shades to do his Terry Silver impression. Let's see, he's saving some page count for what the backers themselves tell me they want to see, which is fair. He did that for Godbound as well. The Kickstarter is to fund the printing of a full-color offset print edition of Worlds Without Number, along with art costs involved. So I'm guessing he's already got the manuscript finished. I do like that he has an anti-DRM policy. I always appreciate that.
He's just giving PDFs. That's it. Yep. Those are so easy to pass around.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. Apparently, he said all art he commissions for Worlds Without Number will be released for free personal and commercial use by others, as he's paid the artist for full rights.
Ooh. I mean, first of all, you know, congratulations on paying your artists. Artists sometimes get shafted really fucking bad.
Mm-hmm.
Second of all, that's an extra amount of money to be able to go, okay, I want all rights to the art you're making for this. Sure, you can put it in the agreement, but the artist is going to want more because of that. Because they like their art. They make their art for, not just for you, but for themselves, and they want to keep that art if they can. Welcome, Maddie. How's it going?
How you doing, everybody?
We're doing good. We're currently on Worlds Without Number. And
it's the most people I've ever seen in the Gazette.
Mm-hmm.
Thing going live, don't you know?
Yeah. but yeah, when it comes to this Is it any surprise that I'm probably going to be pitching in on Worlds Without Number?
No, it's no surprise, especially since Skies with, or Stars Without Number and Godbound are just so good as well.
Yeah,
he has a quality that he keeps to very, very well. He's consistent, but also excessive. He's consistently excessive, which is, I don't know, probably the best combination.
Yeah. Also, this is not the first time that I've highlighted one of his Kickstarters, because you may remember a few years ago I highlighted Wolves of God.
Yep.
Which is very good. The only reason I didn't do a full review of Wolves of God is because I felt like I would have been dipping a little too close to what I talked about with his previous work.
I mean, he even mentioned Wolves of God right here. These shipping costs range from $25 to $30 extra, depending on the non-US location, because he has to transit the cost of shipping the book to people who are getting the rewards.
Mm-hmm.
He says, unfortunately, but his experience in fulfilling Wolves of God obliges him to recognize us.
Which makes sense.
Yeah, I definitely understand that shipping to places outside of the big major places is... Like, just shipping this to someplace like Brazil would be hard.
Well, that's going to be hard because the Brazilian government is the Brazilian government.
Yeah. But I, This amount of transparency, again, another consistency from him, because I've seen his other Kickstarters when you've brought attention to them and when I've just come across them kind of perusing Kickstarter. He's always been very transparent about his costs, his goals. And as I said, the thing I find most admirable about his stretch goal statement is he says he appreciates, you know, the marketing value of adding stretch goals, but all of the successful RPG Kickstarters he's run have been built around a simple, specific set of goals and rewards.
Yep.
And that focus not only allows him to create a very high quality product, you know, the manuscript, like you said, the manuscript's probably done. And this is mostly for, you know, getting things like additional art and getting things like that physical edition and helping with all of that sort of material kitsch.
Mm-hmm.
And that focus, I think, is probably the most important thing for his success with these Kickstarters.
Mm-hmm. Now, next we have a little something from FASA, and I will note, I did get in contact with FASA and the developer for 1879 here. He is open to coming on. We're just negotiating a date and time.
It's a lot of non-humans there.
So 1879 for this is going to be for the Players and GM's Companions, and I am chuckling at the current amount raised. And let's,
I think we all are.
Look, I had a small chuckle when I saw how much the soundtrack for Sigil cost.
Yeah.
6.66 euros.
Mm-hmm.
But
and then you immediately had a head desk for what was it? The board game we looked at just a couple weeks ago.
Return to Planet Apocalypse.
Yes.
So 1879 is a Steam Weird game that kind of asked the question, what if the shit that happened that created the Sixth World in Shadowrun happened a few centuries early? I.e., what if the magic cycle got jump-started in the Victorian era?
Well, now Dunkelzon is King of England rather than President of the U.S. That reference had to be made. I'm sorry.
God damn it. So yeah, the Age of Steam gives way to the Age of Electricity, We have clockwork computers and even crazier shit, including the fact that you have the British army facing off against the Samsut, descendants of the Babylonians and Akkadians, with their own weird science that allows them to raise the dead and use zombies as shock troops and skeletons as fire and forget munitions.
And also to create the perfect woman out of a computer program.
Weird science!
Exactly!
God.
Monk, I'm full of references. Don't test me.
Though to be fair, the premise is actually pretty attractive right now.
Yes. Yeah. I like the idea of loading an entire skeleton into a bazooka and just shooting it.
For me, what makes it even funnier is for those metalheads among you all, imagine loading Eddie into a cannon. Not Eddie Guerrero, Eddie.
No.
Oh. Oh. Oh.
Or just animate a skeleton, give him the ability to talk, then put his head in a cannon and fire.
Wait, not you want get, me to fire? You want only, me to fire the Great Papyrus out of a cannon?
Yes, I actually wasn't going with the Great Papyrus. Let's go with Skeletor.
Hey,
man!
Hey, service of the cartoon circus of the cartoon stars.
I imagine that Papyrus just sounds like a really upbeat Skeletor.
That's kind of been memed into existence.
Yeah, it has.
going full circle by having Skeletor's voice actor do Papyrus's lines.
I'm not gonna lie. Yeah. There was a time where I was on a stream with some friends playing through Undertale the first time, and they wanted me to voice any characters I thought I could voice, and the first thing for Papyrus was a hot nasal, slightly nerdy voice.
I think that's what people do. Like, I know Shades did that for a while.
That's pretty much been the accepted rule, just as how for Sans, it's a New York accent, specifically a Brooklyn one.
Either a Brooklyn accent, or you get a really deadpan, deep voiced guy.
Mm-hmm. But let's see. So it's doing it. So we have the player's companion and the GM's companion, which are going to be expanding. It's basically shorthand for all the stuff we couldn't put into the core book. I'm perfectly fine with that. So they'll make a specialized medal at 7,500. At 10,000, they'll be putting out a poster of one of the cover art pieces. And at 1,500, they'll be putting a poster-sized map of the Groove Fort Alice area. And some additional stretch goals beyond that, but that's we'll cross that bridge if we get to it.
I think you meant 15,000.
Yeah, 15,000. And they got 26 days to go. They're asking for 5,000. They're at 6,661.
I think they'll at least make the $10,000 stretch goal.
Yeah. I did send him an email saying, I know I shouldn't, but there's a part of me that wants the funding amount to stay at this number solely for the memes.
I'm sure they had a laugh at that.
Yeah. So next is one from our old buddy Ed Jowett. And this is one that we talked about a few years ago, but that was when it was being made as a small size book. Now he's going full size with it. And that is Era Forbidden.
Just $16 away from funding.
He's going to make it.
Yeah, with 21 days to go.
This is okay. What are your stretch goals? Kind of territory at this point.
Yeah. Yeah. Because, well, Ed's company, Shades of Vengeance, has 40 Kickstarters under their belt.
Yep.
Yeah, he's going to make it.
Mm-hmm. So, Era Forbidden, which he outright cites Darksiders as one of his chief inspirations.
Darksiders is a very lore-heavy place, actually, and mm-hmm. it's nice to have that as inspiration.
Yeah. So, it is exploring a world where angels and demons have appeared and torn human civilization asunder in their war, mainly inspired by Hellboy and Darksiders. The players take the role of Forbidden, people who have touched a remnant from that war and grown to superhuman levels of strength, putting them on par with smaller angels and demons. It is balanced for small groups, playing best with two players, but works excellently for a single player and GM. Also for larger groups, if you choose so. I've only done duet games a handful of times, and doing duets is not a style that I'm particularly fond of. I can do it. It's just that. You know how you need the right kind of people for a really good time at a table?
Yeah, you need to have that right connection even for small games.
Mm-hmm. I'd say even more so for small games since there's less people to bounce on.
Yeah, if you're going by the suggested numbers here, it's either just you and one other person or you and two other people, and mm-hmm. that
My preferred minimum is three people.
I can see that. My preferred minimum is generally three people because you get them bouncing off of each other really well that way.
Yeah. Now this has been playtested since January of last year. There's already a pocket rulebook, which I have.
And nice.
The pocket rulebook is very light. But that doesn't mean it's not bad. It's just meant to be a very simple approach. Era Silence is also like that as well. He's got a decent amount of really good pocket RPGs as well as the full sized one. But for Era Forbidden, he wants to make it full size. So he wants to put out a core rulebook at 250 pages long with full illustrations throughout. And has a history of the conflict, details on locations, factions, and people, remnants, and as well as a create your own remnant guide, a bestiary of angels, demons, and humans, 15 sessions to help you get started.
Very nice.
Some of which are grouped into campaigns. He was doing a playtest campaign like he did for Lost Legend, which I did participate in. I didn't participate for Forbidden because I wanted to give that slot to somebody else.
And this is where we all post our good guy monk memes.
Yep.
Yeah. But yeah, I'm going to have to get on him about this. Do I hear one?
Oh, no. Where's the typo?
Era Forbidden is a fun, fast-paced, story-driven RPG.
You better be lucky.
Editor!
Yep.
Better be lucky I wasn't
Editor.
A meme.
No. This isn't as bad as the guy behind Kyrie writing his location as Philadelphia, which Ethan Van Sciver ripped into him about playfully, of course, but he admitted that when that was brought up on one of Uncle Ethan's streams, he ended up having a sink into the chair moment. And I had asked him about that, and he took it in stride, thankfully, when I asked. Because I had asked him, where's Philadelphia? But...
And better question, where's South Philadelphia, where the EC Fuffy Arifa is?
But,
That was harder than it sounds, by the way.
Yep. So what we have is angels and demons decided to start fucking around on Earth. This happened 50 years ago. Most of humanity's been wiped out. There's still some pockets that are left, but the apocalypse came and went. So now we have a literal post-apocalyptic game.
So, post-apocalyptic nerd clerks?
The thing is, I know some people would be like, "Oh, the angels are coming. They'll save us." Nope. All that the angels care about is killing demons, and anything else that happens is collateral damage.
Tell the angels acted in Darksiders, so I mean, it's no surprise.
Yep. But a small number came in contact with weapons or equipment scattered all over the world by the war, because obviously there's plenty of dead angels and demons laying about. Those who do bind their soul to the items, becoming stronger than humans, but also less than human. Players take the roles of these forbidden, forced into near isolation by the rest of humanity, as well as the animosity of angels and demons.
So you're just becoming a Nephilim, except weaker.
Mm-hmm.
Got it.
Well, obviously, there's a possibility of getting more relics or being attuned to the relics that you have is going to make you more a more powerful Nephilim.
I'm not going to get into how far Darksiders lore goes all about this. That's an entirely different discussion.
Yeah,
I believe
Just state that the Nephilim that you're probably thinking of and the Nephilim from Darksiders are not the same thing.
Yeah.
And yeah, we have that a bit of a audio explanation on the world. It's using the Era D10 rule set, which is a fairly light approach. And definitely works. I say as I've run it. If you're familiar with the basics of World of Darkness, you'll get it. It just doesn't have all the weird stuff that's in World of Darkness. Like you roll a number of d10s to try and get over a success threshold. If you roll tens, you can roll another die.
Exploding dice.
Mm-hmm.
I love exploding dice.
If you roll more, if you fail and roll more ones than successes, you fumble.
Yep.
Let's see. And just like before, he's doing individual videos on the rules, character creation, brawl, melee and ranged, and skill rolls. Then the campaign Escape the Feed.
An actual gameplay session, which is really cool.
Let's see.
Or set of gameplay sessions, I should say.
And we have the goals, along with a catch up pack, which I'm not going to need. The apocalypse pack for Era Survival, which I already have. Let's see, and then we have the team responsible. And the red tape. So, yeah, this is. Let's see. So, let me see how close he is. So he only needs like £22 more, I should say, and he'll have met his goal, and he's got 21 days to go.
12 pounds.
Sorry.
I was going to say, he'll definitely make it. I actually don't see any stretch goals listed. I don't think he has any.
No, I don't see any. Let me double check. Nope, no stretch goals.
Darn.
No, that again, I'm seeing, I guess, a small pattern of people who have multiple successful backer projects on RPGs like this, especially ones that are really good, such as the Era games, such as Stars Without Number, they tend to focus on what is important, the game, and eschew the stretch goals, because if they can fulfill the game, that's the most important part. Especially when they're smaller teams like Shades of Vengeances, or when they're a one-man band like Kevin is. I think that's good for them. I think it's good that they're not promising more than they can keep up with.
Mm-hmm. Now, our last one that we have is Weird Space. And Paul Katt has been on the show. In fact, I had him on the show months before this was even announced. The subtitle for Weird Space is Sci-Fi Bollocks.
Mm-hmm. I love the humor behind all this.
Sounds like my kind of game.
He's already at 912 pounds of the 300-pound goal, so he's way beyond his original goal.
Yep.
And well into his stretch goals. He's got a part on his stretch goals that says, "We're in unknown territory beyond this figure. Okay, now we're getting beyond my wildest expectations for this Kickstarter." Mm-hmm. This is where I'll take some time off work to get the first source book started.
Yeah.
I think he'll hit that. He's got 26 days to go. I think he'll hit that easily.
It is a D100 system. Anything nice. Under 5 is a critical. Anything over 95 is a botch. So even if your target number is over 100, there's still a chance of things going wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. So then we get into the setup. He has outright cited a lot of British sci-fi as his inspirations.
Red Dwarf?
Yes, Red Dwarf.
It makes sense.
I love Red Dwarf. So I'm like, what could it be? Gazpacho soup. That's what it could be.
And of course, I did have to make the joke of, is that why you're not allowed to bring any hand puppets to the table?
he has your interview on his Kickstarter monk.
Yep. It's nice to be recognized.
I've seen a lot of Kickstarters recently. Anybody that you've had an interview with this and specifically even talked about some of their projects, they've included. I really appreciate it.
Yeah. I just got to make sure to not let it go to my head.
I think that'll be pretty easy too for you. Too
late.
That's why I said too late.
Mm-hmm. I think what definitely helped in this case is that there's a quick start version that's already available for free.
Mm-hmm.
And he's done a few things when it comes to doing promotion over in Leeds. He said, "First time you ever had applause after a one shot." And I just have to go through some of the responses. Should have been a standing ovation from the event organizer. Pixie nightclub with exotic dancing fish, though. Dr. Pirate robotic fish in a lab coat, though. And apparently a local band called Pulverse was kind enough to let him use the song Do or Die on their Kickstarter. And, what the hell is that dice? Also, the guy on the far end looks a little bit too much like somebody from WrestleTalk.
Dance, Chopper.
Does he not look like it? Does he not look like an angry punk version of King Ross?
Oh, it's Cultaholic, yeah.
Yeah, what the hell am I saying?
The end is nigh, the end is why, fucking run away, the end is nigh, nigh, nigh.
I love that guy.
I guess if for making that mistake, I guess that would count as Monk O'Clock.
Yeah.
Oh, don't get me started on that.
So, as far as the news,
it's my clock on clock every. Get in there. Like swimwear.
Okay. Now with the spotlight out of the way, let's get to some bullshit. So first off, I'd like to give a hearty, heartfelt fuck the Watsy.
Fuck the Watsy!
Fuck you, Watsy!
So, with the newest errata, and I want to point out that I find the amount of errata updates that Wizards of the Coast has been doing with 5th edition to be excessive. It's like they're trying to do the same kind of update frequency that you'd see in competitive card games, except the reason that those kind of updates are done with competitive card games is because they're competitive card games. Emphasis on competitive. Have I not said competitive enough times?
Competitive.
You could probably use a few more, but I was about to say, I didn't know that 5th edition was Magic the Gathering the tabletop.
Look, if we want Magic the Gathering the tabletop, I've got Shades of Dominion. That does the job better.
Yep, that works.
I'm totally not saying that because Carnal Conservative has been on the show and I've talked with him a bunch of times. but they are going to remove racial ability penalties because of the upcoming Talsha's Cauldron of Everything. And when I first found out about this, I had stated on Twitter, "You want a cookie? Because you did this back in 2008. This isn't new."
Except the words you're looking for, Monk, is simply the words of Chris Farley. Well, I de freaking da.
Pretty much. Except the funny thing is, and the reason why they're doing it is because they're trying to appease the people who still have that bullshit idea that races in D&D are representative of real world races.
Yeah, Monk, you're just an orc. I know you'd rather be an orc than an elf anyway, though. So, I mean, it's all good.
Yeah. But for 4th edition, and I was there for this, so I remember exactly what the reasoning was in 2008, and I'd say the reasoning made more sense then. They had argued that it was becoming harder to justify needing to have +2 in one stat and -2 in another stat. And one of the examples that they cited to say that it was kind of a stretch was Warforged having a charisma penalty.
So, I'm going to be a little honest here. When it came to racial penalties, I hardly ever applied them in my own games to people because I was like, it, to me, it just, like you said, hard to justify +2, -2 somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So I would just tell people, you know, here, make whatever is a +2 somewhere, a +1, and then cut out the neg. It'd lead to a little bit less, you know, overpowered, which is also part of the aim. Yeah. But it also allowed players to play races they felt like they couldn't play because of a neg stat.
Now, putting aside the fact that once you get into higher levels, race doesn't matter all that much.
Yeah, your racial bonuses and your racial negs aren't really a factor once you're a high enough level.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly because you've got, you know, all the fun little magic items that give you, you know, +8 strength and shit like that.
Yeah.
belt of cloud giant strength, anybody?
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, you've got a sadistic DM. No one I know who has you run into decks of many things a few times.
Yeah.
I don't know who that could be. I don't know.
Stop looking at me.
I'm Monk, my TV screen that I use as a as a monitor is very reflective, if you get my drift.
Yeah, I got you. But for D&D 4th edition and for 13th Age, their approach was, okay, pick from one of these two ability scores, you get a plus two in that one. 13th Age did it where they did for both race and class. The only catch was you can't pick the same ability score for both. So if you're playing, say, a human fighter, you can't put your racial bonus into strength and your class bonus into strength.
Con and Dex, why the hell strength?
I'm just using that as an example. The point is that they're expecting me to applaud them for something that their predecessors figured out. And they figured it out better.
Mm-hmm. Being outclassed by your predecessors is probably not a good feeling for them.
Maybe you should have kept Heinzo and Tweed around. Instead of throwing them out just so you could get Merle's in charge. The guy who's been a third wheel his entire career.
Merle's. Why does that name sound familiar?
Mike Merle's.
Oh God. He's in charge? I never realized he was in charge. I knew he was involved. I didn't know he was in charge.
Yeah. And
cold day in hell. It's a cold day in hell, everybody. Or a cold year in hell.
But they're doing this because of that whole diversity statement. And I'm like, this is not going to change what you think it will.
It's just going to make them think that they're racist in other ways.
Yeah. We're gonna be going through this dance again in 6 months. You wait. Well,
I'm specifically talking about the errata includes an update to Orc's Inborn Menacing, and it's been swapped for Primal Intuition, which gives a choice of skill proficiencies from Animal Handling, Insight, Intimidation, Medicine, Nature, Perception, and Survival. Now Orcs are no longer quote-unquote race-coded as Blacks. They're quote-unquote race-coded as Native Americans! You've changed them from one to the other! At least that's how the woke skulls will see it.
Doesn't that make it worse, though?
Yeah! Yeah!
Yeah!
This is only going to switch the target from, oh, you're just making, you're just using orcs as typing for Blacks. Now it's going to be, you're using orcs as typing for Native Americans. And nothing's going to change. The woke scolds are just going to just change tax. That's all that's going to happen.
I don't know. Maybe they can hire Dan Snyder as a consultant.
Hail to the Deadskins. Oh, I'm sorry. Washington football
team. Hey! Just because the shield uses it doesn't mean we have to. So I will say it until I'm forcefully hogtied and forced otherwise. Hail to the Deadskins, because no matter what your name is, you still suck.
Damn straight.
True that.
Is it bad that when you said Dan Snyder, I thought Dan Schneider?
No. Not that guy.
Fuck him too.
Oh, wow.
Put your motherfucking head back down, dummy.
But,
It'd be about the same, right? If Watsy hired either of them for this.
Yeah. And the funny thing is that some people tried to argue the Native American stand-in once for druids, which just showed their ignorance, and that's the thing I always find kind of funny, is that people will argue that they're fighting against racism by being bigger racists.
Right. That's like a spike right in my frontal lobe, monk. Druids are Native Americans. No, druids are Celtic, you shits.
Yep. Now let me bring up the mood a little bit.
Yes. Let's bring up the mood.
As soon as
pulled a spike out of my head already.
Yeah. So the old D&D cartoon never got its proper finale. It got shit canned before they were going to air the final episode. And some fans decided to, after a script was put out, make the final episode themselves, including getting some of the old cast together to do voice work.
Aww,
that is awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And just remember, the Dungeon Master is the source of one of the greatest memes ever. It's magic. I ain't got to explain shit.
I still hate that guy.
You can hate that guy, but the meme is genius.
Oh, it is. But yeah, this was a very faithful reconstruction. There was a professional disclaimer saying, "I have attempted to follow Michael Reeves' script to the closest letter, except places that were beyond my abilities to create. His script ends at 28 minutes on an open ending that he was instructed to write by the producers, should the series continue to a fourth season. The extra events that occur after are strictly my ideas, discussed with co-creator Marshall Hubbard, on how to close out the series, with concepts and events stemming from previous stories, and attempt to bring a definitive closure to the story of the search for a way home."
I still never get the reason that people who are isekai look for a way home.
I'm willing to give it a, given the young age
with the D&D, with the D&D cartoon, I understand why. Mm-hmm. They're children.
But
I get that.
Look, am I gonna have to bring back the Escaflowne rant?
No, we've been through it too many times already.
Yeah. Just saying. So next we have something coming around from Monty Cook and Sean K. Reynolds. Nice. He's making a multi-fantasy setting called God's Forsaken.
In the Cypher system, obviously, because, mm-hmm. you know, it's Monty Cook.
Yeah. And the Cypher system doesn't suck.
The Cypher system is really good. I actually really like how it plays.
Yep. So it says God Forsaken includes high fantasy in the style of Tolkien and Jordan, urban fantasy like the Dresden Files and Buffy, paranormal romance, whimsical fantasy like Discworld, wuxia, sword and sorcery, and gritty low magic settings. You know, given the fact that The Strange is meant to be a multiverse approach, this makes sense.
I want it.
Mm-hmm.
I need it.
There are appropriate rules, character options, and gear, and a ready-to-use setting that capitalizes on the breadth of fantasy options. The rules offer up options for magic, often an essential element to the fantasy setting. I don't know if I'd say essential.
I see a magic blunderbuss. I'm already sold.
Mm-hmm. The Cypher system is expanded with new playable species. Now, somebody once argued, "What if I'm so bent out of shape about the whole switching of races to ancestries, why am I not bent out of shape over changing it from race to species?" Because species actually makes fucking sense.
Well, and because in normal nomenclature, race and species are synonyms.
Yeah.
It switched from race to ancestries. Okay, ancestries is what you're descended from. That doesn't necessarily indicate what race you are a part of.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas changing race to species does
yep.
indicate exactly what race you are a part of because it's your species.
Mm-hmm. So, new creatures to encounter include basilisks, liches, manticores, elementals, and wyverns.
No cockatrices? Nothing for H.C. Bailey to scream at?
Yet. It has a free preview, and the print edition is open for pre-order with a due date of late November, and shipping on pre-order starting before that. I am not going to be getting I probably will get this, but I'm not going to get the printed version. The main thing that I'm going to be curious about with this, because there's already been high fantasy in the Cypher system. One could argue that Numenera counts as high fantasy. I would contest that. But
it's post cyberpunk.
Yeah. But there's also some stuff like Gods of the Fall, which is very much on the epic fantasy end of things.
Yeah, it's just like our continent full of black technology and god kings.
Mm-hmm. But what I'm curious about is how it's going to handle all these different genres. And yes, I'm particularly interested in how they're going to handle Wuxia.
I saw Wuxia and I was like, tasty. I want it.
So next is the return of Fu. Freeform Universal, which is a universal style RPG I haven't seen in a long time.
It calls from the ancient time.
The beta rules are available for free, and although this is a second edition, it's a work in progress. There's some sections missing, as well as a lot of art missing. You could feasibly run a game with the base rules. It seems to use descriptive words to define characters, and is more interested in conditions instead of hit points. I'd say Fu could work if you need a rules-light, universal approach. I'm not going to recommend it for everybody, though, because obviously if somebody wants more crunch, there's other universal-style games that they can get their crunch fix in. You know, like GURPS. If you want to break out your calculus textbooks.
Monk.
Yeah?
No.
Okay. So next, we've talked a bit about Armada, and now we've got a bit more to discuss. Why am I focusing on Armada? Because I like ship combat. That's why. So, they put out a battle report of, I believe it's Dwarfs versus Basilians. And the idea of Dwarven steampunk ships makes me smile.
They look like tanks on the water.
Yeah. I could imagine them fielding a fleet of nothing but those old ironclads that you saw during the Civil War.
One of these things looks like half of a battle barge from 40K.
Yep. So you build your fleet, which is probably going to be using around 6 to 9 ships. So effectively with this battle report, we have a dwarven fleet and an orc fleet.
Oh, those poor orcs.
Which probably explains the red sails.
Those poor orcs.
Of course, the bigger the boat, the more expensive it'll be, but the more powerful it'll be. You have two... So it goes from tiny, an orc rabble, small, a bomb boat, medium, a hammer fist, large, a smasher, and extra large, a ripper hulk. And you have main battleships and support ships. For each main battleship, you can add up to 2 support ships into your fleet. There are also named vessels, which is self-explanatory. It's kind of like independent characters.
For example, the Flying Dutchman could be a named vessel.
Mm-hmm. Of course, then you can put in upgrades, much like in Kings of War or in Vanguard. Some standard or magical ones. The magical ones feature names that'll be familiar to players of Kings of War. There's the Brew of Strength, which makes boarding actions more likely to cause crushing blows. Or the Sails of Honey Maze, which enables a boat to take an extra move step once per game. Although standard upgrades can be given to any ship, the potentially more powerful magic upgrades may only be given to main battleships, and you can only select one of each magical upgrade per fleet. So you can go crazy with it, but you can't go too crazy. And of course, there are captain upgrades. So, in case you want Barbossa to be at the front of your ships.
Nice.
Why'd I go with Barbossa instead of Jack? Do you really see Jack as somebody who could command a fleet?
Yeah, I don't see it. Barbossa?
They can see Jack commanding a fleet through sheer luck, since it is his luck stat that is maxed the fuck out.
Okay, that I'm willing to buy.
The man survived being pulled into Davy Jones' locker without actually dying. Come on now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's just that he, I would say he kind of went crazy, but he went crazier with all the other Jacks talking to him.
Yeah.
He had to talk to someone, and he didn't have a volleyball, nor was he Tom Hanks.
Yeah. So in the meantime, One Page Rules is putting out what they have planned for October, along with Faster Than Light, which is going to be their latest entry. And One Page Rules is exactly what it says on the tin. They make different games. All of the rule sets have to fit within one page.
Nice.
That forces ingenuity. That forces innovation.
It can. I was hanging around on the Mork Borg Discord server, and one thing that some of that group has been doing is what's known as album crawls, one page dungeon crawls, except they have to be based on a music album. The first one that I found was based on Demons and Wizards.
Oh, jeez.
And each part of the dungeon was a song, was a track from that album.
Oh man.
Which leads me to wonder what would happen if you did a set of album crawls on the entire Emerald Sword Saga.
No.
All the way from Legendary Tales to Power of the Dragon Flame.
The real question is would it just be based on the titles or the lyrics?
Porqueros dos.
Yes, okay. Porqueros los dos, I get it, yeah, okay.
Like, you could do it based on the titles, or you could do it based on the lyrics, or both. Those rules were not specified.
Oh, that's a lot. That's... Can we also make it that you have to listen to the song for the chamber that you're in?
That might be pushing it a little.
Oh, come on! You get to listen to all of the Emerald Sword Saga while playing the Emerald Sword Saga.
The sad thing is, I know Max would do exactly that.
I would too. Yeah. I'm someone who would do that.
So next, we've got a bit of an update regarding the Enemy Within for Warhammer 4th Edition. The third book is coming along swimmingly, known as Power Behind the Throne, which that's an apropos cover for it. We also have some of the interior art, as well as the fact that this is going from Altdorf to Middenheim. You know, the city with a bunch of wolf worshippers. So, yeah, which is fairly in line with what happened during the third edition run of The Enemy Within, if you recall, Maddie. You guys did travel north.
Is it bad that I can't see the words White Wolf without thinking of Geralt and of Exalted? Yep.
Now, for this next one, we have a kid. Now, I first found out about this particular story thanks to Toy Bounty Hunters, and this was a case of Numpty.
What in the fuck?
Two men arrested for allegedly releasing unauthorized game featuring Kamen Rider X8.
There's only one sound needed for this.
Game over.
Oh yeah. Ah!
My question is still, what in the actual fuck? How why what?
Xana, don't think about it too much. You'll get a migraine.
Two men were arrested for allegedly using Kamen Rider X8 in an unofficial app. On September 30th, two men who worked at a game app development company, aged 39 and 34, were taken into custody for allegedly violating copyright law. According to the police, these men are suspected of creating a game app using Kamen Rider X8 without their permission and then distributing the game online since December 2019. They're also under investigation for releasing around 70 additional apps which use licensed characters without permission. They have made around 50 million yen, or $473,187, from advertising costs total in these past 3 years. Both have admitted to the charges.
Okay, one, good enough for admitting to charges. Second, the fuck, people!
There's a small part, I know it will never get released, but there's a small part of me that would like to see the full list of all those apps. At the very least, yeah. if it was just the case where they just got busted for using X8, I'd be like, maybe they could get off with a slap on the wrist, but the fact that they've got 70 apps that they've been pulling this shit on,
I would not be surprised if they tried to go after Toei's other Pantheon of characters, like Sentai and the other Riders.
I wouldn't be surprised if they did.
I would not be fucking surprised.
What makes you think they'd stop at Toei?
What makes you think that they'd stop at Tokusatsu?
Toei, Disney, couple of other franchises. Mm-hmm.
This was just the one that they got caught on. You want to know what would have made this even funnier? If it wasn't X8 that got them caught, but Genem. They were cursed by God Dan Kuroto.
Oh, I love this one.
So, this is one where I wish I had Doku on for, but we're getting more Goblin Slayer.
Did somebody say goblins?
Oh, God. So, Yen Press has announced 4 new manga and light novel acquisitions, including a new Goblin Slayer series.
Ooh.
One called Daikatana, the Singing Death.
What?
That's what it says.
One of the stories, Daikatana.
That's what it says.
No, it's full. Its full name is Goblin Slayer Gaiden 2. Can't read those kanji. Those kanji are so stylized.
Mm-hmm.
I'll have to look up those kanji later. But yes, the first kanji I can't read, but then it's No Daigatana. Yes. And then, of course, in a katakana just above it, it just says Daikatana.
I just can't stop thinking of John Romero.
No, this will
stop laughing.
This will be. Okay, so those two kanji there that are probably what is being translated as the Singing Death.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see what these are.
I needed that laugh.
Tuba Mei. I don't actually think that's supposed to be the Singing Death.
Tuba Mei, isn't that Swallow?
No, that's Tsubame. Tsubame is different than Tuba Mei. It's Sword Guard and Ringing. So it's the Ringing Tsuba of the Daikatana.
Okay, a little bit roundabout, but I can see why Yen Press wrote it as the singing death.
Well, I mean, everybody's watched cool-ass samurai movies where the sword is slightly ringing just before they sheathe it, and then everybody falls down dead.
Yeah.
I'm guessing that is what the reference is to. Mm-hmm. But this character is not the Goblin Slayer. It's very Japanese.
It's why it's a side story.
I know. He's a different Goblin Slayer. Yeah. Or she's a different Goblin Slayer. I can't tell.
This adopts the upcoming light novel release and continues the story of the Sword Maiden as she takes on the Demon King.
Yeah, okay. So that's the Sword Maiden one, probably.
Mm-hmm. And they also apparently acquired when a magician's pupil smiles, which... which is going to be an omnibus collection. Then, I was a bottom-tier bureaucrat for 1,500 years, and the Demon King made me a minister. What is it with isekai and needing to have excessively long titles?
I don't know, Mark!
It's not just isekais that do that. It's light novels in general. It's hard to explain it culturally because it's very, very unique to Japanese culture. I don't even understand it fully.
And I can't just blame it on light novels because, well, Vampire Hunter D and Gwyn Saga are light novel series, and those are pretty simplistic names.
Yes, but when you see these long names, it's generally that the source material is a light novel.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not just isekai light novels. We see it for a bunch of other light novels. Yeah. And the... Again, I don't understand the humor behind it fully, because it ties into parts of Japanese culture I don't fully comprehend.
Yeah.
But it's seen as humorous to write things this way.
Mm-hmm.
It's meant to make you think that this is going to be a funny story with serious beats to it.
Yeah.
And more than likely, when the anime adaptation comes around, it's going to have a read the light novel ending, because that always fucking happens. I hate that shit.
So, speaking of which, Godzilla's trying again with another anime. Oh, hopefully Jesus. It does better than the last time they tried this.
Yeah, good luck. You're going to fucking need it.
Godzilla Singular Point.
Mm-hmm.
It's a film.
It's using actual anime and not CG, at least from the key art.
Yeah.
So Zell, you know how you just said you hope it's better than the last one?
Yeah.
Your response was predicted by one of the responses on this tweet.
Yeah.
Oh, August Ragone, I remember. I know this guy. Good luck on that advance.
But all I can say is good luck, because you're gonna need it, since the CG trilogy was not very good. Although the winning comment goes to Dan Plol, who said, "I misread it and instead created the most edgy, metal, and badass name for a movie ever. Godzilla Slaughter Point."
Yeah. I have not seen the CG Godzilla anime movies, but I remember one thing from it. And that's from that series of Mechagodzilla, from a meme on Tokurips, because it wouldn't fucking start. I just find that funny.
When it comes to Mechagodzilla, the one thing I'll say is after Tokyo SOS, I despised the Mothra fairies. Because here we have... I hated them for a while for being annoying, and I don't like fairies, period.
Yeah.
I hated them after that because it's like, we finally have a... Japan finally gets a weapon that they can reliably use to go toe-to-toe with kaiju. But no. Mothra wants it taken down because it's using the bones of the original Godzilla. Like, I liked Tokyo SOS, but that was contrived as fuck.
Yeah. You and I ain't defending that bullshit.
Almost as contrived as any trigger ending that goes to space.
Yeah.
So, we kind of talked about this last week, and looks like I can pull the whole fuck you, I was right. Because did I not say a week ago that the fact that Eden Zero was getting game adaptations meant that there were probably sowing the seeds for an anime adaptation in the future?
And we agreed with you.
Mm-hmm. And I figured this would take me at least. I figured it'd take at least a month before I ended up being right. Nope, 7 days.
Wow.
I guess that you could say it took seven days for that rumor to die.
Ruben right in a week. That's a new record.
Mm-hmm. So yeah. Hiro Mashima has confirmed that it will be happening. The anime will arrive in April of next year. And along with that, they released key art, as well as a few character arts that we'll be dealing with. Although Shiki's goal of making 100 friends, I think there's a certain writer who can relate.
Yeah.
Yep. Pretty much.
Mm-hmm. Let's see, Rebecca Blue Garden, The Return of Happy. And we already talked about the two games that Konami is making, which, I'm keeping a close eye on, not to see whether or not they're going to be good, but to see whether or not they're going to fuck it up. You know, at the very least, with the recent Fairy Tail game, they did the smart thing and hired Gus to make that. Next, Valiant is trying again with trying to bring their properties into the silver screen. Namely that DMG and Paramount are working on a Harbinger film for release sometime next summer. Paramount apparently bought the rights from Sony, which removes it from the Bloodshot universe. And Valiant's also releasing a new Harbinger comic in the process.
Hmm. Interesting.
Yep. And let's see as far as the design, Please don't colorize this design if these art images are any indication.
Yeah, they're pretty gross looking.
No, what I'm saying is that this is kind of like trying to add color to Ashley Wood's art style.
Mm-hmm. I just think it looks really muddled and garish.
But of course, these just could be proof of concepts. We have no idea if that's what the final work is going to look like. And Valiant has been around for a long time, but they've kind of been the third wheel in the indie scene. Like, even outside of the big two, Valiant isn't talked about as much as other companies are.
Well, kind of a.
I think There have only really been two times I've really discussed them. One was the absolute fail that was Faith. The second was the live action ninja thing they did on their YouTube page, which was actually pretty decent, and In a case of life imitating art, they had JDF playing Bloodshot.
Which I'd
actually argue that JDF did a better Bloodshot than Vin Diesel did.
Yeah, I can agree with that.
I can see that.
Also, a cameo appearance by Jomo.
Because why not?
Look, I'm just saying, if there's one person who I think deserves to be in more comic book movies, it's John Morrison.
Yep.
Hell, he did. When it came to that one video, he did such a good job playing Casey Jones. I'm like, why didn't they just make him Casey Jones?
Weird.
It's in that video of Casey Jones versus Kick-Ass. Which, to be fair, in any way you look at that fight, Kick-Ass is losing.
Yeah.
Kick-Ass is not Casey Jones. Of course he's losing. I'm sorry, but trained versus untrained.
Even if I'm not entirely sure if I'd call Casey Jones trained.
Fine, battle hardened.
Yeah, I can go with that.
Yeah, that's a lot better.
Yeah.
Well, still say trained because he fights like he's playing sports still.
Well, he did play amateur hockey.
Hockey teaches you how to fight. You're good.
Pretty much.
But it looks like we've got a full on trailer for the SSSS Gridman follow up called Dynazenon.
Dynazenon is very, very good.
Yep.
I actually talked with a couple of my buddies in the RBT server about this, and one of my friends was like that the trailer didn't tell us anything about the show, where honestly the first trailer for Gridman did the exact same thing.
Yeah, this is what we call a teaser, people. This is not a full-on trailer.
Yep.
Yeah, it's a teaser.
It's a really good teaser, too. The music's good. The art is fantastic because, well, it's the same studio, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, Studio Trigger.
Yep. Because, well, it's Trigger. Hey, wait, there's another point for if they don't go to space, the series is fantastic. Quad S Gridman did not go to space, and you saw how good it was.
Yep.
And already people have been trying to link up the character designs to Transformer characters, which some fans have already figured out one of them. Like one of the main characters in the Studio Trigger announcement tweet about the show is based on the unreleased toy for G2 Grimlock.
Doesn't surprise me.
Mm-hmm.
But I am looking forward to Quad S Dynazenon.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, I'm very much looking forward to this.
Yeah. We don't have a proper release date yet, but we'll get one with time, I'd imagine.
More than likely, we're probably going to get one with like a full actual trailer for the show.
Yeah.
Likely.
More than likely.
And can I just say that Studio Trigger is a very inspired rags to riches story?
Yeah.
Remember that when they all escaped from on Gainax. Mm-hmm. The Anno show, which he hates. Anno hates that it's just him now. He really does. Of course, I think Anno just hates the world at this point.
Are you saying that Anno is the Japanese Alan Moore?
I will plead the fifth. the Trigger crew started with shoestring budgets using what are normally animation tricks to save budget as tools within their own universes. Looking at Kill la Kill, you can see this very easily, that they're using them as sight gags, as it's like, well, we need to put in this shortcut here. Well, it's going to be obvious. Well, then turn it into a sight gag. Okay. And as they've gone further on and gotten more and more budget, their animation quality is phenomenal. And while some of their story quality has not always been the best, once we hit the space arc, it shows that they're trying to create something grandiose, even if they fall short. And I love that because, you know, these guys are the same guys who did stuff like Gurren Lagann back when they were in Gainax. Mm-hmm. And I love that they're always trying to do something more and more epic. So the fact that Gridman was so good, and now we're getting Dinozenon, I am looking forward to it. It's not even tentative or cautious. It's, I want to see this.
Yeah, and another thing about Gridman that was so good is, like, you didn't even have to see its original source material to really understand or really enjoy the show.
Exactly.
Oh, there were even a few nods to friggin' Cyber Squad in that show.
Yep.
Yep.
Which is, again, why the Quad S is there is because of Cyber Squad.
Yeah. Now, for the next, in the announcement that everybody saw coming. Yep. Season 5 of Hero Aka is officially coming around, and we've got full-on key art.
To the surprise of absolutely nobody!
Did I already tell you guys that I've dropped the manga because I'm pissed off at Koei?
Yeah. You did.
Did I tell you why I'm pissed off at Koei?
Yes.
I have not, but please forsake my sanity by not saying why.
I'm probably not going to watch season 5. I might. If it has I might watch the part where Shinso gets to fight, because Shinso fighting is definitely something I've wanted to see. But
although I couldn't help but notice when it came to the key art is most of the outfits have remained consistent. The couple things that I can't help but notice is one, Bakugo going full bodysuit.
Yep.
And two, Momo getting a cape.
Yeah.
Doesn't look too bad on her.
Mm-hmm.
That's not bad.
I know that there was that whole set of let's take the cast and make them fantasy characters. I hope that gets like a OVA or something like that one day.
That would be hilarious.
But I think Vigilantes is more likely to get adapted.
Yeah.
Yeah. That seems much more likely.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. Next. The guys behind the Castlevania anime are working on a Greek-themed show called Blood of Zeus.
So half of Greece, got it.
Yeah. somebody did, the blight meme. Somebody did a variation of that of Batman Beyond playing a Greek hero saying, "You banged my mom," and Zeus and Blight as Zeus saying, "Do you have any idea how little that narrows it down?"
I get it.
I love that meme.
I mean, my favorite version of the "you didn't narrow this down and it's so mundane compared to other things I've done" meme is Raul Julia as M. Bison, "But for me it was just a Tuesday."
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But for me the appeal with something like Blood of Zeus is getting the kind of animation we got from the Castlevania anime and applying that to Greek legend. And it looks like in this case we have wars between the gods and giants. Or rather, demons who apparently have been eating the remains of giants.
Okay, then.
Just saw there's no Kratos. 0 out of 10 already. Not even interested.
Oh, God, if there was a Kratos in, the series. God, you might want to fortify yourselves. Keyword on attempt.
Also, I know some people really didn't care for the second and third season of the Castlevania anime because it started doing its own thing. I didn't have as much of a problem with that.
I still need to watch the Castlevania series.
You should.
I had no interest, so I just skipped it.
I've had the mindset that I don't care for this idea that an adaptation needs to so slavishly follow its source material. Especially if, say, you're adapting a book into a film. You're adapting it into different mediums, and different mediums have different requirements. And right. There are things you can get away with in a book that you can't get away with when your time is on a tight leash. But next, we also ended up it has been confirmed that Netflix Witcher is getting a season 2, and in the process, we ended up getting a photo of Geralt's new armor.
I need to watch the Witcher series on Netflix too, and holy crap, I love that armor.
Somebody already photoshopped it to make him look like the Lich King.
Yeah, yeah.
Fucking guards.
Ah!
That doesn't surprise me.
Mm-hmm. Regardless of how I feel about the Witcher's Netflix series, which I find to be a mixed bag in places.
It's closer to the books than some other adaptational stuff I've seen. So, yeah.
I have the utmost respect for Henry Cavill.
Oh yeah,
Henry Cavill's cool.
Mm-hmm.
Henry Cavill's a freaking nerd.
And I think the fact that he contacted people who had worked on the games to try and get the character right speaks volumes.
Oh hell yeah.
Yeah, he sat down with him for like hours.
Mm-hmm. And although I do have to say this, if anybody wants an example of why I hate bards so much, Dandelion.
Hey, Yaskir's cool. Don't you dare.
I will dare.
You'll dare and you'll dare to be wrong. Don't worry, it's a free country. You're allowed to be.
So, in a similar vein to a bit of my surprise once this thing loads, Kingdom Come Deliverance is getting a live-action adaptation.
What?
Wow.
Yeah. It's being produced by Wild Sheep Content, who are also going to be doing the Yakuza live-action movie, when it comes to that, which I'm hoping that they don't spread themselves too thin when it comes to this, doing two major IPs at once. They haven't decided.
I'm gonna head off for now, guys. Have a good one.
All right, stay frosty.
I'm ready.
They haven't decided whether this is going to be a series or a movie. I could go either way. The main thing that I'm concerned about is how closely Warhorse Studios is involved.
I imagine that they're going to be involved pretty close.
Well, Martin Frivoletsky, sorry if I mispronounced it. You know how it is with Eastern European names. But he's apparently the CEO of Warhorse is co-producing. But the thing about being a producer on a film, it doesn't mean as much as people think. But next, Crucible is canceled. And if I had the button, I would say hit it, Sven. Months after release, and after canceling it earlier and putting it on only on Amazon, basically taking it off Steam, the Amazon finally full-on canceled it. They are discontinuing development.
Oh, shit, I actually have the button.
Well, then hit it, Sven.
Sound can't be found. Fuck this new phone. Never mind.
Damn it.
Don't get my hopes up like that. And apparently the team is being absorbed into the dev team for Amazon's New World MMO. So I think, which is probably for the best. Instead of having a bunch of people working on different projects, Amazon should have had as many people as they could work on one given project, namely New World. And when it comes to something like Crucible, that thing was dead on arrival.
Yeah.
Mostly because of the fact that it was trying to be a hero shooter, but it didn't really offer enough that was different from its contemporaries. Never mind the fact that hero shooters are kind of an overcrowded market nowadays.
Yeah.
And we'll probably talk about that in more detail tomorrow. But I remember seeing Crucible and I'm like, okay, what's the hook? And I just couldn't get in bed with it. Like if it had some gameplay angle or something, or if it was emphasizing scale, maybe I would have tried it. But no. I wouldn't be surprised if this gets a episode of Death of a Game in, I'd say, 3 months. Probably an episode that's only going to be like 11 minutes instead of the really long ones like the Mixer episode.
Mm-hmm.
And now we have GameStop's potential exit strategy. So they're getting into a partnership with Microsoft to sell Xbox All Access, utilize Microsoft 365, Teams, and more. This is being referred to as a multi-year strategic partnership. Aaron has stated that he thinks that this is going to be an inroad to Microsoft purchasing GameStop. I don't think that's going to happen because the risk would not be worth the cost. Because if they end up purchasing GameStop, then GameStop would have to only sell Microsoft products and games and so on. And you'd end up having a lot more customers pissed off over that, because that'd mean any customer who is going in for Nintendo or Sony or PC would not be able to go to that store anymore and would have to go elsewhere. So when it comes to this particular, it seems to be a lot based on them using some of their office software instead of the gaming stuff. It also would fit in nicely with the rebranding that we talked about last year that they want to do. You know, where they want to make their stores more of a gathering space. You know, kind of the same thing that a lot of mom and pop game stores do these days.
Yeah.
And I can. There's definitely going to be some changes now. As far as, like I said, I can certainly see the potential for a Microsoft purchase. I just don't see it as being feasible yet. Ask me in 2 years. Now, next, this is another case where I get to say, "Fuck you, I was right." Also, fuck Schreier.
Yeah.
Because... Oh, the crunch rumor bullshit that I didn't pay attention to because I know Schreier's an idiot.
Schreier seems to be on this crusade what I'm getting the vibe out of Schreier currently is that of all the people who have the gatekeeper attitude within games journalism, Schreier's the perfect example of that, where he thinks that the only way to legitimize news is to have it reported by him or somebody like him. And he apparently really has it out for YouTube journalists.
Because he's retarded.
Now, yes, he did expose Crunch in other companies, and it seems that he's trying to scrape the bottom of that particular barrel as much as he can.
Because it makes him look ethical when he's not.
Yeah. But Game Informer during one of their podcasts, and Legacy Killer had also talked about this, that the rumor per Leanna Ruppert's discussion on the matter, the whole thing is being blown out of proportion. Saying there was a discussion on do we want to delay the game again or do we want to do this. Reportedly, her sources said that a mass majority agreed to the 6-day work week. And, of course, it's worth noting that overtime made during Crunch is paid overtime, alongside the 10% revenue that CD Projekt splits with the team members. So I can see how they're not seeing it as Crunch. Also, as Upper Echelon Games had pointed out, you have to understand that you're dealing with a different culture when it comes to how they see work weeks and these kind of projects. You're dealing with a Polish company, not a North American company, if there really was a discussion on the matter and they decided to work on Crunch so that they could actually get the game out instead of just delaying it again. I have no doubt that there were probably disgruntled employees who talked to Schreier, just as there were non-disgruntled employees that talked to other sources.
Yep.
But what I do think, however, is that Schreier's reporting was irresponsible, because the vibe that I got from his take on the matter was that he was framing it in the narrative of CD Projekt being fat cats at the top. You know, it's the kind of narrative that's meant to trigger emotions.
And it's the kind of narrative that you would normally see being said about, you know, places like Bethesda or EA.
Yeah. The problem is Bethesda and EA are US companies.
US AAA companies. Mm-hmm. CD Projekt Red is not a AAA company. Though they do make AAA quality games.
Would you say that they're more akin to an indie studio with a massive budget?
Maybe starting out, and even now they're still very small. I wouldn't say that they're quite at indie level anymore.
Double A,
probably. Maybe even just, you know, a single A. But they're small and tight-knit. They make fantastic games. And they aren't, you know, as large and expansive as the AAA corporations around the world are.
I wonder if I could compare them to Valve in the early 2000s.
I was thinking the same thing. You know, just 50 or so employees and everybody's tight-knit and working together, mm-hmm. sort of thing. Yeah, they're very much, you know, how is Valve? Indie size with the heart of a AAA, I guess, was a good way to put them.
Yeah. But this is the reason why it's important to not jump on a story the first chance you get. I know a lot of journalists like doing that because they want to get them clicks out. But the problem is, then you end up having to issue corrections, and you end up looking like you just mooned everybody in public. Because when I saw about the crunch thing, I felt like it was an attempt to try and do some more shaming towards Cyberpunk, because there have been no shortage of controversies involving Cyberpunk 2077 over the last year.
I think there's been a lot of people, first because of the delay, and then because of, again, the rumor mill, saying things like the game's going to be bad because CD Projekt Red doesn't make first-person shooters and blah, 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 blah. It's like, okay, just because there's going to be first-person and shooting elements in it does not mean that CD Projekt Red can't make a good game out of what they've chosen. And they say it's slightly shorter than The Witcher 3. Okay. And length of a game doesn't indicate quality either. There's been, like you said, a lot of controversies. And I've seen it coming from people who were initially excited for the game. Now they're starting to think that CD Projekt Red is somehow becoming like the rest of the untrustworthy game companies out there. I'm confused about it, to be honest.
It very much looks like people looking for witches, and I get it. I get the whole
irony.
Yeah, which is definitely ironic, but it's more of people needing something to hate.
Mm-hmm.
And this just happened to be the target of the week. Speaking of targets, we're dealing with another Joy-Con lawsuit.
Oh, God.
Not again.
A mother and child have sued Nintendo over the drift defect on some Joy-Cons, asking for over $5 million.
Really? Do you think that's a bit too much?
Yeah, that's a bit too much.
So, here's the thing. Nintendo began repairing the Joy-Cons for free. All this mother and child have to do is send the Joy-Cons in.
Mm-hmm.
They will not win this lawsuit. Nintendo has too many lawyers.
Yeah, pretty much. And, given how Furukawa has repeatedly apologized, this is pushing it. Luz Sanchez and her son, a 9 or 10 year old referred to in court documents as MS, have filed a class action lawsuit in Northern California for over $5 million against Nintendo on the drift issue. The lawsuit states after Sanchez bought her son a Nintendo Switch in December 2018, the Joy-Cons allegedly began to drift within a month. And why are you waiting 2 years to do this lawsuit? Allegedly, less than a year later, the Joy-Con drift became so pronounced that the controllers became inoperable for general gameplay use. There was already a replacement program. Why didn't you take advantage of that?
Well, and then they
said that new Joy-Cons were purchased, but then they drifted as well.
So, the replacement program didn't come in until last year, if I'm remembering correctly.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
2019. But the claim of defendant continues to market and sell the products with full knowledge of the defect and without disclosing is absolute and demonstrably untrue at this point. They have come out and stated in a press release that they're aware of the issue, they've apologized for the issue, and they're sending repairs for all of the issues for Joy-Cons prior to a certain date. Because Joy-Cons after that date no longer have the graphite heads that were causing the issue.
I have no idea what Luz Sanchez looks like, but based on the wording of this by her counsel, I've got a few good guesses, and I'm guessing that she's got a bunch of bracelets, if you get what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
You know, A lot of pearls.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Or for you Harry Potter fans, Imagine a Hispanic Dolores.
Oh, I'm just going to say a Hispanic Mega Karen.
Yeah.
That'll work too.
Should he use La Chancla?
Yeah.
But now let me raise my glass in honor of Sucker Punch blowing me out of the water with this 1.1 update and what's going to be in it. And this comes out in 6 days.
Mm-hmm.
Now, already, for when it comes to Ghost of Tsushima's single player as it is, it's fucking great. Go get it if you can. But, one, we're having a co-op multiplayer mode that's coming out for free. Two, update. Now, first off, a lot of the Legends thing has to deal with, well, Legends of Goshima that Gyozen might tell you. And when it comes to the update, here's the most important one: New Game Plus.
Yeah. Yes.
Second is the ability to kind of slot in a charm preset for individual equipment.
Oh, finally. They're inputting something that I really wanted and never got. Fucking kits.
Mm-hmm. Yep. They're adding more charms. So a final upgrade for your weapons. New trophies, the ability to earn ghost flowers, which can be accepted by a new merchant. Completing tales or actives you've already beaten will earn you ghost flowers as its reward that can be exchanged for armor, dyes, and vanity gear, as well as new charms. More options on the photo mode, as if it didn't have enough options as it is.
Oh my god.
And of course, Legends, which is a co-op mode, which as mentioned before, has four types: Samurai, Hunter, Ronin, and Assassin. And I do love that they put this in for the Ronin description. You might play Ronin because you want to help your human friends. Or you might do it because the Ronin class is able to summon a spirit dog. And yes, you can absolutely pet your spirit dog.
This gives me an excuse to go back and play Ghost of Tsushima through again.
Mm-hmm. I always love New Game Plus.
What's funny is I have the platinum trophy for the game. I didn't stop playing until I got that.
And there are certain fights that through New Game Plus I'd like to do again. The big one especially is the Kojiro side quest.
Oh man, that side quest was so good. And now you'll be able to replay them like mm-hmm. endlessly if you want to.
Yeah.
Because the only way to earn ghost flowers is by beating tales or activities you've already beaten.
Yeah. Plus, I'll have another chance to do the one mini game that I ended up having the hardest time with. Bamboo.
Well, bamboo's easy though.
It took me a little getting used to.
I mean, I can understand that because you only have a couple seconds to put in all the buttons, but mm-hmm. it wasn't bad.
Yeah.
And of course, there's actually for people. I really liked that there were accessibility options for people who may have had issues with the game.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them was one that took out timing requirements for things like the bamboo cutting. Yeah. For anybody who may have had timing issues or they just don't have the nervous acuity to tap buttons that quickly.
Mm-hmm. Or they don't have enough caffeine. Or Adderall, because apparently Adderall was used as a PED in some esports.
Yes. In fact, Adderall could definitely be used as a PED in esports.
Mm-hmm. Which I think it's since been banned.
Yes. Yes, yes, it has.
Next. So who remembers Warhawk on the PS3?
I do.
Apparently a fan project called PS1, or PlayStation Online Emulated, is working on reviving the Warhawk servers, and it's currently in closed beta.
Jesus.
Ooh.
I don't have a PS3 anymore, so guess I'm screwed on that one.
And I'm surprised that the game had such a hardcore following, because it kind of came and went. I know that they tried to do a spinoff with Starhawk, which didn't last. Even so, I do have a soft spot for the PS1 Warhawk and the cheesy ass FMVs. But yeah, it's mainly reconfiguring your local DNS settings to their server's IP address. And then the rest is, well, fairly obvious.
Yeah, like you said, the game kind of came and went, but it got a good core cult following at that point.
Mm-hmm. Once it's authenticated, you can just go with it, and. When it comes to it, everything looks the way it did back in 2007. And they're currently in beta with it, so obviously there's not going to be a whole lot of players just yet, but they're hoping to go full open later on, and look, I'm perfectly fine with this, because we all know the world needs more arcadey style shooters. You can never have enough of those.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
So next, this is a case where I have to press X that Starbreeze and Overkill are claiming that they're still working on Payday 3, and apparently they're using the Unreal Engine. Probably because the last time they tried using their own in-house engine, it backfired hard, because remember Overkill's The Walking Dead?
No. No, I don't remember that. I purposefully forgot that, so I won't remember that. And mm-hmm. You can't make me.
They're shooting for a 2022 release window, but I don't see it happening. And to be honest, I see it likely that more people are going to still be playing Payday 2.
Yeah.
Especially since through putting aside the fact that Payday 2 is still getting updates even a decade later, there's of course the fact that. Well, no matter how many updates it gets, the drill still sucks. Mm-hmm. Also, I get the feeling if there's one character who is a living meme in Payday 2, it's Dozer.
Yeah.
A very large man in a bomb suit with a very angry minigun. Also, I like some of the crazy ass builds that people come up with Payday, where somebody did a stub version of a minigun.
Oh god!
Oh lord!
A short barrel minigun, so it's effectively a chain shotgun, or like the riot gun from the original Shadow Warrior.
Oh god, I remember the riot gun.
And because of the perks that he picked, he can go for infinite ammo for 20 seconds. Just burts all around for days. Let's see. Waste in Exile is apparently working on some other stuff since they supposedly have some new RPGs in production just after putting out Wasteland 3 just a month ago.
Yeah, but they do stress to say that you know, it's in the infancy of pre-production. It has just started.
Yeah, so I'd say they're still in the point of arguing at the table. Okay, what should we do next? It's probably not going to be a post-apoc game, and it's probably not going to be Wasteland 4. It's way too early for that.
Yeah, and they're still, you know, they're still currently focusing on post-launch support for Wasteland.
Yeah. So next, there was this little thing that Nintendo had put out, Super Mario Brothers 35.
Oh yeah, I've been on that shit ever since it got out. Still haven't reached first place yet.
What I get out of this is somebody taking the original Mario Brothers and combining it with Tetris 99.
Yeah.
Which is essentially what it is.
Mm-hmm.
That just sounds less fun to me.
It's a speed challenge.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, it's basically like you go through each of the Mario levels from the original Super Mario Brothers. You defeat enemies and gain time. And if you defeat enemies, they'll go to different people depending on who you target. Like, you target your attackers. It's essentially like Tetris 99, only with Mario and more platforming. And people can actually win in this one instead of just wondering what the hell is a T-spin is.
I know what a T-spin is, but that's because I'm insane.
I know exactly what a T-spin is, but that's because I used to play Tetris, the original, on Game Boy for somewhere between 4 and 6 hours a day when I had no other games to play.
I was playing on arcades. Get on my level.
Excuse me, there were no arcades in the area I lived in, Monk. Fuck off.
Anyway, one little title that I have been waiting on for a long, long fucking time is finally coming stateside, and that is Uppers.
Oh, this game!
This game just sounds like a drug trip.
With that, I'm gonna bounce. I need to get ready for Toonami.
No worries, man.
We'll see you there.
See you later, Zell.
But yeah, Uppers, which as you're seeing in the footage, may as well be a bit of a drug trip. It is a beat 'em up. And one that has its own brand of crazy.
Of course it does.
It feels and like what would happen if somebody hired the River City Ransom guys and told them to go nuts.
I love it.
Mm-hmm.
I love it.
I can't wait for this game to drop.
Yeah. But yeah, this is coming on the 21st with a at 30 with a digital deluxe edition at 40. Looks like it is coming to Steam on October 21st. The PlayStation 4 version was being worked on, but it's no longer planned for North America.
That's fine. I want it on Steam anyway.
Mm-hmm.
PC superior.
Fuck yeah.
So next, Ziggurat 2 is entering early access. It's going to be on early access on October 22nd. And this is essentially, I guess the best way I can describe it is, what would happen if you made Heretic a roguelike?
What?
Nani?
That's the vibe I get from this.
The original Ziggurat wasn't like that.
The reason why I'm making the Heretic comparison is, well, because FPS with magic. I just think Heretic.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I can see that. Okay. Roguelike magic FPS. Okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
And obviously with a lot of tongue in cheek, because this is not a game to be taken seriously. Especially when you have evil carrots.
Yep.
And what looks like a non-trademark infringing version of a caco. that's what they look like. They look like cacos, just not caco enough to get id's attention.
I don't think id would even mind.
Oh, they didn't mind when somebody made a caco demon cake.
Exactly. Like, yeah. I don't think id would even mind. Bethesda might. Bethesda got bitch slapped by id last time they tried to interfere in id's shit.
Mm-hmm. And since I think id knows that they could just up and leave if they felt like it. Bethesda's probably not going to try that again.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
So, another thing that we're getting coming from the Mad Lads at THQ Nordic is Aquanox Deep Descent. We've had a lot of ship shooters into space, so why not we bring back a reboot of one that's going underwater?
This is basically just taking the Descent games and putting them in the sea.
More or less.
Oh well, then. I hope all those people with thalassophobia out there are going to be okay.
But this particular trailer that they put out is focused all on the crazy-ass weapons. Because apparently it looks like they're doing the whole thing of switching out weapons on the left and right hand. And IR, which means plenty of DACA, but not enough.
It's never enough, DACA.
Mm-hmm.
Only when everything in the universe is simultaneously being killed and brought back to life by all of the bullets, and every bullet occupies every space forever, only then will there perhaps be enough DACA.
The thing that's definitely going to make a prospect like this interesting is, well, degrees of freedom. I mean, obviously that's why I made the Descent comparison earlier, because the thing with something like Descent is you have total freedom in the levels, which is going to be both a good and bad thing. I do love the cockpit design.
It's a nice one. Makes you feel like you're in a submersible.
Mm-hmm.
If that submersible is yellow.
No. I know where you're going with that, and the answer is no.
Had to make it.
We don't live in it. Don't worry.
None of us are British enough for that. But it looks like they're going to be heading out October 16th. And there's probably going to be some crazy because, well, it's THQ Nordic.
Man. Next,
good.
Lots of good shit.
Yep. Next we have, from Team 17 Digital and Warp Zone Studios, Hammer Ting. Which has got to be the best name out of everything that we've covered so far tonight.
It is the tinging of a hammer. What else needs to be explained?
We are dealing with a dwarven mining colony in the mountains of Mara. So, Dwarf Fortress. A mining colony sim with RPG elements. This is basically Dwarf Fortress with a budget.
Yeah, that's the vibe I'm getting from it.
Or rather, a side-scrolly Dwarf Fortress. Maybe with a little bit of Lemmings.
No! No.
Well, I was gonna compare to Oxygen Not Included, but I don't think that would count either.
Nah, it won't.
Not Dwarf Fortress. PTSD, Monk. Why?
It looks like even though you do have the mining colony, there's a whole other overworld to deal with, so.
And they're going to mine right into the lava, like all of them.
I do like that the song Diggy Diggy Hole has the line, we can never dig too deep. And then in the comments it said, Balrog has entered the chat. But I love this when it comes to the skilled craftspeople part of the description. Anyone can craft an iron sword, but only dwarves can haggle a crystal cave dragon to sell her fiery plasma breath. Pump it up to an Anthril Forge of Doom and use it to craft an iron sword plus two. Let's see. So next, Raji, an ancient epic, is getting a prologue demo. We've talked about this game in the past. It's very much inspired by Hindu and Balinese mythology. And we're dealing with the story of two siblings. Now, this demo had previously been time-limited to Steam Game Festival, but has now been made permanently available since the game's coming out in 5 days.
Mm-hmm.
And it is very twin sticky from what I'm seeing of it. So obviously I'm interested.
I need a new controller before I start playing twin sticks again.
I just use my PS4 controller.
My PS4 controller doesn't map the games correctly.
And why not get an Xbox One controller?
Because they break on me. Specifically the joysticks' axes start bending, and they get stuck in certain positions around the actual degrees of the circle.
Yeah, right. It did happen to my old one before.
Although when I see the way combat moves in certain regards, why do I keep getting reminded of Mark of Kree?
I'm getting that just from looking at the stills. Is Mark of Kree?
Mm-hmm. It's probably a coincidence, since Mark of Kree was a very Polynesian-influenced game, and this is going for India.
And not to mention, the Mark of Kree also decided your attacks based on not just the direction of right stick, but the button on the controller.
Yeah. So then there was this little thing from the Diablo 2 modding community, a PvP roguelike called Leoric's Castle.
Oh, hey, it's Skeleton King Leoric.
So it reintroduces the cathedral dungeon found in the original Diablo with a focus on multiplayer and boss rushes. You can play with or against other players in free-for-all, 4-on-4, or some kind of variation in between. They wanted to make a mix between speedrunning and PvP, taking place between the first and second game. So the bosses that'll be in it are the Butcher, Archbishop Lazarus, a Balrog, Garbad, the Black Knight, Etrigan, and King Leoric. And as you progress, you can upgrade your gear with gold.
Yeah, okay.
I almost said Etrigan, and I was like, nope, we can't have that in this game. DC would sue us.
Etrigan.
Mm-hmm. Which is one of those cases of legally distinct.
You are technically correct, which is the best kind of correct.
But obviously, like I did in the past, if I were to run this, I'd probably be running Assassin again.
That'd be fun.
But the I'm curious about the kind of crazy that happens when you introduce PvP into Diablo. Because that will probably create a lot of crazy. But it is nice to see that there's that Diablo 2 has a still has some really good mods in its quiver.
Yeah.
So next is something that I believe Andrew Gilmore had recommended to me, or at least brought it up to me. I think it was him or somebody else.
ExoCore.
ExoCore, which is now on Steam Early Access. The vibe that they're going with is tribes on the moon.
And then Macross. Tribes and Macross.
So are they like doing the whole space colony thing or whatever?
No. Tribes, because of the whole changing your loadout type thing with the jetpacking and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. And Macross because you can missile spam.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and I already like what I'm seeing out of it. I love the suit designs. And yeah, I can see the missile spam.
So
looks like we're also going to be in, I'm assuming, either Mars or Arizona.
Same place.
Yeah, they're basically the same place.
No, Arizona is Mordor.
But Mars is a planet of Mordor.
Unfortunately, it doesn't have Deja Thoris. That would have made it so much better. And I know some DC fan is going to say, but what about John Joe's? What about John Joe's?
Oh, John Joe's. Jinx.
The last thing that we have is some new footage on Mecha Knights.
Want it now.
Which the good news is that it's still being worked on. The bad news is that it's been delayed to 2021, and this is basically a mech horde mode game.
Yep. And it's got the same. It looks to have the same dashing system as Armored Core and Demon Ex Machina.
Yeah. And unlike a certain other horde mode based game, it's not going to be just backing up and shooting. Seriously, that's the reason why I never got into Serious Sam.
Yeah, Serious Sam's draw is not the actual gameplay; it's more the humor.
I guess.
But if the humor isn't your brand or taste in humor, then it's kind of mediocre.
It only really worked for me in Serious Sam 2.
Mm-hmm.
3 was meh, and from what I've seen of 4, it feels like it came out of a time warp. But what I'm seeing out of the mech customization here is, obviously, because of the way this kind of game is set up, there's probably not going to be a whole lot of melee weapons. In fact, I'd imagine that you're going to want to stay out of melee as much as possible. Mm. But I do like the I do like that they're a little more loose when it comes to what they'll classify as shoulder weapons.
Yeah.
Like having the kind of anti-air turrets that you would find on ships on the shoulders of your mech.
Which would make sense.
Which leads me to wonder. I can only imagine what sort of unholy setups Troa Barton would put up on this kind of ship.
You're asking what the king of Gundam missile spams would do with a mech.
He's not just Gundam missile spam. He's Gundam everything spam.
Yeah, full open. I'm going to open my chest with the Gatlings. I'm going to use my Gatling shield cannons. I'm going to use every missile pod on my Gundam. And you are going to get hit by 10% of it.
as I said a long time ago, I have had the feeling that each of the main Gundams in Wing was tailor-made for a specific combat environment.
That's not a feeling. That's demonstrably true, mm-hmm. and also, I believe, explained as being canon in the side story mangas.
Yeah. Wing was very much in air and space superiority, as well as some anti-fortification with the Buster rifle.
Twin Buster rifle is broke.
Yep.
Yeah.
Sandrock, self-explanatory.
Desert. Stealth.
I'd say stealth is more Death Scythe's domain.
No, desert stealth. He's a desert skirmisher. That's what I'm saying.
Whereas yes,
general stealth is definitely Death Scythe.
Mm-hmm. And I'd say also a bit of nighttime or sensor limited tactics.
Yeah. Yeah, he's an infiltration bot. Mm-hmm.
Which I know somebody might say, how can you infiltrate when you're a giant mech? People have to rely a lot more on sensors in mech combat. And he's very good at jamming sensors, so he doesn't show up.
To mention the fact that Death Scythe has active camouflage.
Yeah. Shenlong/Ultron, my guess was always forced combat.
Yeah, I can see that. It's a little bit less in all directions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
there's a reason Wu Fei gets curb stomped in every goddamn battle.
it doesn't.
Other than the fact that Wu Fei's an asshole.
Yeah, he is. I mean, each of the pilots had one screw loose, but he had more screws loose than he had tightened on.
So, the story behind Gundam Wing is that the series writer hadn't ever done anything prior to that besides, I believe, boys' love shows.
Oh.
Yeah. That's why the character archetypes were kind of fucked.
Although I'd say some less fucked than others. I'd say the two most stable people in the crew were Catra and Duo.
Catra goes insane. Don't you remember that?
Oh yeah, I forgot that. I take that back. Then the only person who has the closest bit of sanity is Duo. I said closest.
Here's what I'm going to say. And you're going to agree with me when I finish this point. The two most stable characters, this has nothing to do with their sanity, but how consistent they are as characters, how much you can rely on them to act the same way every time, are Hero and Duo.
Which probably explains why they end up becoming friends.
It also explains why Hero tells everybody he'll kill them. You, Miss Peacecraft, the woman who's trying to bring peace to the world, I'll kill you. You, Zex, I'll kill you.
Also,
Omae Koros is a meme for a reason.
Yeah. Also, the last one on the list is Heavy Arms, which was very clearly designed for urban combat. Why? Because with a lot of buildings, there's a lot of choke points where he can just sit his happy ass down and make sure that anything living that pokes its hole out from a few hundred yards is not living.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's not just urban combat. Heavy arms is all about suppressive support.
Yeah.
All about suppressive support.
And well, you're not going to find a better place to do that than in urban combat.
True.
So like I said, lots of really, really easy sight lines. Also, I'll put it like this. Zex Marquise is a better Char clone than Char Aznable. Is a better Char than Char Aznable, I'll put it that way. Which I know is blasphemy, but I'm sticking to it.
It's not blasphemy so much as you can't really be a better Char when you aren't a Char at all.
He was very clearly designed to be the char of Wing.
He was very, very clearly designed to evoke the feeling of Char, but his characterization is nothing like a Char.
Mostly because he's actually capable of building relationships and keeping them,
and also not trying to absolutely destroy the fucking Earth.
Not having a bit of character assassination. Look, I hated Char's counterattack, I'll put it that way. I hated it when I first saw it and I didn't know any better, and then when I finally saw Zeta and Double Zeta it, I hated it even more. Because throughout his time as Quattro, it seemed like he was starting to turn a new leaf. And then all of a sudden, nope, time to adopt an extreme version of my father's old idea.
Well, the issue there is you're missing vital information. You can't just rely on the animes at that point. When you're going from Mobile Suit Gundam, the original, all the way to Char's Counterattack, there is some written material you have to read to get the sight between the lines.
That I shouldn't have to. That's a failure on their part.
Nobody said Tomino was perfect. There's a reason he's called Kill 'Em All.
Yeah, including his own fucking brain cells. But that's gonna do it for this one. Tomorrow is going to be a bit of a doubleheader, because at 4 p.m. Central tomorrow, I will be bringing back Dr. Baron Bell to talk about Dominion, Fall of the House of Saul, since he's gearing up for Volume 2 of that. And at 9:30 Central, we will be returning to Geek Watch, with the topic this week being the rise, fall, and renaissance of shooters.
I think the renaissance of shooters has only occurred because we're going back to shooters that were good.
That's the well. I was originally going to call it the rise, fall, and rise, but I didn't like how it worded out. So I just and since renaissance means rebirth, I used that instead.
I mean, you could have always gone the Mad Max route and gone, they live and die and live again.
No. Save that for when we talk about Mad Max on its own.
Okay.
And of course, I do want to thank everybody who took the time out of their schedule to come and enjoy the insanity. I'm glad to be doing this live again. It's a lot more fun.
Oh yeah.
At least it's not Bill O'Reilly versions anymore.
No.
I'm very glad that Discord is no longer trying to destroy you.
I don't know. Maybe all the threatening emails finally got through to them.
Maybe the reason they weren't responding to anybody on the forums was just because they were quietly fixing it in the background. Why they didn't say that, I don't know. It still doesn't inspire confidence.
I'm not going to look a gift horse in the mouth.
True.
So we'll see you all again here tomorrow. The review for Project Biomodus is just finishing up. I should have that done within 24 hours. So keep an eye on that. But until then, on behalf of the good brothers present and not present, my name is Mildra, I am your gaming monk. Stay